All right, so here we are live on Periscope with Watercolor Wednesday. And that's for the YouTube people who are watching the broadcast on YouTube. All right, so now the first thing I'm going to do while my watercolors sort of, you know, sit and get all nice and juicy in the water is we're going to sketch. I really like this photo. I think this one's nice too. I did put both on my website, but I think my preference is this other one. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to draw. I'm just drawing the shapes that I see. So I'm going to focus on this sort of triangular shape here of his body. And then there's a little, you know, a little kind of round ball for a head and a little triangle for his beak and then some legs. I'm going to focus on that. It's just drawing the shapes that you see. I'm just using a light pencil. You may not be able to see this on camera, but I'm going to go over it with black pen in just a minute. Hey, Cheryl. You know, if you've watched me draw before, then you know I have a tendency to draw all of my girls kind of fat and chunky. Might be because I'm fat and chunky. Yeah, it seems like I'd like to draw peacocks that way too, because I'm already noticing that my bird was a bit on the fat side. I guess it doesn't really matter. So now I'm going to put his head in. And I'm just sketching out the shapes. I'm not really shooting for sketching in lots of detail. I just want to give myself a map of where my colors are going to be when I start painting. And then he's got this like cluster of small feathers behind him. Yeah. Let's not forget his legs. Good morning, everybody. I hope you guys are all having a great day. I've already been to the gym, did my thing with my morning workout. So now I'm just gonna draw some suggestive lines going out, you know, to suggest his large tail feathers. Now, even if you have, if you're doing something like this, and even if you've chosen one, you know, particular photo for inspiration over the others, I like to have the others out because they give me nice reference for detail and for color. Yeah. All right. So that's my basic pencil sketch, what I don't think you can see a lot of, but we're going to go back over it with some pen. And I'm not using anything fancy. This is just a number 2 pencil. It looks different because this is a Faber-Castell Jumbo number 2 B pencil. It's just fat. It's a little easier for me to hold and draw with. You know, I have some arthritis in my hands, so this is a little bit easier for me to hold. But any number 2 pencil will work, or mechanical pencil, which I have around here somewhere. This is just a Sharpie. This is my new favorite pen. This is a Sharpie marker pen. This is a stainless steel one, and it's refillable. You can get these at Target. You can get these at Staples, and you can get the refills also at Staples. I haven't seen the refills at Target, but this whole part comes out. This is refillable. You still have your pen body, and you just get a new one when the ink runs out and put it back into the stainless steel body, and you're good to go. And this, because it's Sharpie ink, it's waterproof, so this is a fabulous pen for drawing, especially when you think you might be using it in a piece that is going to later on have any wet mediums on it. So now I'm going to go and I'm going to sketch my bird in. I'm going to maybe alter some of the lines to be a little bit more refined, I think is the word I want this morning. I'm referencing the photo. And I'm not going super dark with my pen lines because I want them to accent the paint, but I don't want them to be the focal point of the piece. You could use, if you have a like a carbon ink pen, this is a carbon ink fountain pen, this would work. Any fine tip waterproof pen. You definitely, because you're using it with watercolor, you want it to be waterproof. If you guys have any questions, let me know. So back here with this shape here, this is like a cluster of feathers. I don't know if you can see that. I'm not going to do lots here, but I want to suggest some of these sort of fish scaly shapes. They remind me of fish scales. I haven't done a peacock before. This is a first. If I screw it up, you're going to see it live on camera. So hopefully that won't be the case, but we'll find out. His eye is right about there. Okay, now I don't want to forget that peacocks have these. I don't know what you call them on top of their head. I know nothing about peacocks, but you can see he's got these shapes, these like feather things that stick out on the top of his head. I'm not going to do any more than that. We're going to do the rest with paint. All right. Are you all ready? Good morning, everybody. All right. I'm going to... You know, I need my clipboard. What did that? I put it away. I don't know where the away place is. You guys have that problem? Oh, hey, I found it. Oh, you guys are good luck. Normally, I can't find the away place. All right. See? Ha, clipboard. Hey, good morning. Okay, now that's going to sit up straight. Ha. Low tech, but low tech is the best tech sometimes. All right. You know, for me, it's like envelopes at the ATM machine and actual key in my car and paper calendars. Low tech. I like low tech. All right, enough about that. These are Daniel Smith watercolors. You can use whatever brand you like, and I have lots of different brands. These are my favorite brands. I know, right? LOL. That's what my daughter just, I say things like that, and she just shakes her head. She doesn't know where to go with that. All right, so the first thing I'm going to do, and with watercolor, of course, right, we start light to dark. And the first thing I'm going to do, you see in the picture here, and this was at a luau that we were at, but you can tell from this picture, and just if you just look at the colors, the base layer of these tail feathers is sort of a tannish red color. And then you see the dark green dots and blue dots. So we are going to start with, I think, some Tiger's Eye Genuine. And that's this color here, which is one of the Daniel Smith colors made from semi-precious stones. And I'm going to put some of this around the outside of our bird. And then I'm going to, I will answer that question in just a second, and then I'm going to just blend it out with some water so we get kind of a wash of this color. So definitely, I mean, my preference is watercolor because it's easy, and I love the challenge of being not in control of my paint. But that being said, I have asthma, which is a long story. I wasn't born with it. It's a long story we won't get into, but I have asthma now, and one of the things I can't do is be around strong smells or odors. They make me start coughing, and they make me start wheezing. I used to do a lot with spray paint art and that sort of thing, and I can't anymore. I have trouble just going to the store and being in the cleaning supplies aisle. So oil paint's kind of a no-no. I do have oil paint sticks, which I love. But I have to be careful, so I stay away from that sort of thing. But if you like oil paint, why couldn't you do this in oil paint, or acrylic for that matter? The technique's completely different, though. All right, I like that. That's a good start. And that's a nice color. I'm going to, actually, now that I'm loving that color, so I'm going to go all around the base of our bird. A big flat brush is great for these washes. I love that. Okay, so we're going to let that sit for a minute. And while that's sitting and that's drying, we'll work on our bird, the body of our bird. So let's start with, he's very blue. Very, very blue. Let's go right into ultramarine blue. Should we go into ultramarine blue? No, you know what? I'm going to start with some phthalo yellow green, just a little bit. Good morning, everybody who's joining me. Okay, like with the other colors, I'm going to put some pigments down and then I'm going to blend it out a bit with water. I'm going to put the water where I want the paint to go, so I'm not going to like put the water over here, and I'm going to try to keep the paint from getting too close to that edge because I don't want it to mix with the brown. Hola, I don't speak anything but English, just FYI. Much to my grandparents' dismay because they were Italian. I have trouble with English. So don't type anything in Spanish, or I had somebody last time do it in Russian or something, because you're gonna have to translate it to English for me. Okay. I like that. So with any painting, you want to start light, work your way darker, and I like the idea of having a base coat of that color. I'm also going to add some Hansa yellow medium, which is the most lemony yellow I have in this palette. And that's just going to make the green a little bit darker. And the yellow's a, good morning, the yellow's a warm color, so it's going to help hint at sunlight. So you want to put this on the parts of your bird where you want to suggest that the sunlight is hitting your bird. And you notice as I'm painting that pencil lines are kind of showing up more because of the pigments in the watercolor, and that I didn't erase the pencil lines. I kind of like them on there. I think they help give your piece interest. You may feel differently about that, so you may want to erase them before you get started with the painting. I like that. I'm going to go in now with some... No, I'm not. Now, I'm changing. So I haven't done one of these before. So you guys are hearing what I'm thinking as I'm thinking it. So I'm going to go in now with my heat embossing tool, and I'm going to dry this because I want to add more color, and I want to add these same two colors here to the spots on the tail feathers but I don't want it necessarily to mix with the brown, and I want to add blue to the bird, but I don't want to mix it with the yellow and have it be too green. So we're going to dry it with a heat tool. And if you can hear me, this is a great time to ask questions. Because, you know, I'm just drawing paint, which is just so interesting. That's pretty good. So now we're going to go in with the same round brush we've been using, and before we do anything else, let's suggest some of the spots in our tail feathers with the same two colors to start. And peacock feather spots are sort of an ovaly kind of eggy shape. And I'm basically going to paint on some green rings. And then I'm going to come into those rings, into the middle, with just some water. And see, it's flipping around. The picture is flipping around by itself. Before I do too many spots, I'm going to come in with my water and let the pigments blend a little bit. Now, you know, this is watercolor, so the layer that I already put on and that I dried can be reconstituted to a certain extent with the application of water, but it's gonna move around less than it would be if it was fresh. And you notice I'm not making complete circles, and I'm being sort of suggestive in the shapes of my circles. I'm more of an expressive impressionist painter, so I tend to not do realism, and I tend to suggest it more than actually draw it or paint it. When I try to draw it, it's usually not good. I'm too used to doing things the way I do. I get too frustrated because it doesn't look like the photograph. Good morning, everybody. This video will be up on Periscope. Periscope, YouTube. And I will do a PDF for it that I'll put up in my Etsy shop. It'll have stills and photos, and it'll have copies of the pictures we used for reference. And it'll have a close-up shot of this or two. So right here, it's a little bit too much pigment, so I'm going to take my damp brush and just pull it through and basically lift up some of those pigments. Thank you. So just go around your bird and just basically paint some green circles. just paint some green circles, and you'll notice from the inspiration photo they're staggered. And they're kind of far apart, because when the peacock has his tail feathers spread out, the spots are far apart. But there should be one on just about every, you know, little line where you want a feather. If you guys have questions for me after the broadcast, you can join my Facebook group called A Life of Art and Self-Expression. And if Cheryl Sigler or somebody else is on who is a member of the group, if you could post the name of it and or the link for everybody, that would be great. So because we're painting something from nature, you know, nature doesn't have straight lines, and it's crooked and goofy shaped. So this is, you know, if you can't draw a straight line or a good circle, this is, you know, drawing things from nature or painting things from nature is right up your alley. I saw Artsy Endeavors on here. Good morning, Cindy. All right, so there's our beginning of our spots. So now we're going to go back to each one, and I'm going to just put in a little bit of yellow. I do take suggestions for Watercolor Wednesday. I'm here every week, unless I am on vacation. And if you guys have something in particular you'd like me to see me paint in a future Watercolor Wednesday, you can suggest it over in the Facebook group. All right, that's not bad. So we're going to let that dry a little bit while we work on the bird, because we don't want to do too much and just have the spots turn out to be just green and not have any other colors in them. So now I'm going to come in with some ultramarine blue. It's called A Life of Art and Self-Expression. And I'm going to try not to do what I just did, which is stick my hand in wet paint. All right, so now I'm going to follow my picture. And I'm going to put in some ultramarine blue. Ultramarine blue is a very bright, true blue. Now, if you were doing this in acrylics, you could start with dark paints and then work your way lighter, because acrylic is done completely differently. Don't be afraid to leave like little white spaces, because those white spaces of raw paper will help suggest sunlight too, which is a good thing. Let's blend out this paint on his head before it gets too dry. Move some of the pigment up here. And let's see. So I'm referring back to my photo constantly. I like my watercolor paints to be kind of unblended and puddly. I know everyone doesn't like that. Some people really like their things to be really blended, but you have to just play with it and decide what you like. I like to have my brush strokes and puddle edges help me suggest my shapes. I'm trying to leave some of this around his face here white, because on the picture of the bird there's a lot of white space on his face, white lines. And you could come back in here with Chinese white or with a white gel pen later, but I'm trying actually to not do that. Okay. Now I'm going to come in over here. I'm going to give this some attention. I'm just putting in some dots, obviously. You can see that, right? I'm going to take and rinse my brush off, and I'm going to touch those dots with water. I'm only going to do two or three at a time before I clean my brush off, because I really want the brush to not have paint on it and for it to have water on it. There we go. I like that. All right, so I'm going to go in with some Payne's Gray, which is a dark blue gray. And I'm going to come in around the edges of our peacock. I do want this to blend a little bit into the ultramarine blue, so I'm not going to dry it. And that'll make, you know, secondary colors that I didn't even put on here, but I'm okay with that. And I'm following the shapes in the inspiration photo that are, you know, the edges of the bird that are dark. He's got, you know, their feathers are sort of iridescent, so the way the camera hit him, some of them showed up darker. Now, you could use any of your cool colors for the shadows if you want to just switch it up and make your peacock a totally different color. Another cool shadow color, or great, I should say, great shadow color is like violet or purple. Okay, so up underneath here, there's some darkness here. And here, and I'm going by my photo. I'm going to put some of this color here where his eye is, and there's looking at our inspiration photo and where the dark shapes are so that I can at least suggest them. Now I'm going to be really careful here because I just said I wanted to leave some of the paper white if we can, which is always a challenge for me because I always end up getting paint, not necessarily, I always end up covering all the white because I just end up with color there. So we'll see. That's actually not bad. All right, so we're going to let that dry a little bit. I'm going to take our Payne's Gray and put some of it up here. And water. Paint and water, paint and water, paint and water. Okay. I'm going to let that dry a little bit. This is really wet, so if I just keep putting blue on here, it's going to just turn more green. So we're going to just let it dry a bit, and we'll work on our spots. Okay. So I'm going to go in with some blue. This is the same ultramarine blue. And it's blending a little bit with the greens and yellow, but that's all right. I'm all right with it. If you want to control how much it blends, then you want to, of course, dry everything with a hair dryer, or if you have a heat embossing tool. I like never use mine for embossing. I just use it for watercolor. We have people popping in and out, which is always interesting. All right. Oops, missed one. Okay, so I'm really wanting to come in here, of course, with, you know, my favorite color, turquoise. Why? Because, you know, I can't help myself. I'm going to actually use cobalt teal, which is a, of all the colors in my palette for this Daniel Smith paint, is probably the one that's the most opaque. And I'm going to be adding a little bit of this. That's a nice pop. But I think I want to dry this because it's blending a little bit more than I want. So let's give it a dry. Let me know if you have any questions. I'm just lifting up the paper so I can see where all the shiny wet spots are. No worries. At least you got the name in there, Cheryl. Thank you so much. Okay, now let's try that again. We're going to go back with the cobalt teal. Yeah, that's better. And in this case, I'm going to leave whatever kind of painty mark I get from the paint brush. I'm not going to blend it because I like the effect I'm getting, the suggestion I'm getting. Yeah, that's a nice color. Okay, so I'm also going to take the same cobalt teal. And I'm going to put it into the body of our bird. I have a lot of books on birds because it's been something I've been playing with painting in the last few months, especially in watercolor. And it's funny, in all the books that I have on birds, not one single one of them has any peacocks in it. I thought that was interesting, I thought. Alright, so I'm going to go back to the ultramarine. While the cobalt teal is wet. And I'm going to come in also with some clean water. I like that. I like the way that's looking very much. So we're going to let him dry a little bit. And let's go in with our Payne's Gray. And let's work on our spots. So I'm going to, I'm barely pushing down on the brush. I need some more water in that Payne's Gray. Okay. So I'm going to just use the teeny tiny pointy tip to draw a thin line in each one of the spots, and then to just sort of dab a blob. Yeah. That one's wet, so I'm going to go up to this one. There's a blob of water on that one. Let's see if we can dry it. Okay, that's better. Just, you know, use the tip of your round brush, the pointy tip. It doesn't even have to be a complete line. It can be a broken line. You just want to suggest that shape that you see in those spots on the peacock feathers. I should have done that one first, because now I'm afraid I'm going to stick my hand in something. And if some of the paint's still wet and it blends a little bit, it's fine. Don't worry about it. What would Bob Ross call that? Oh yeah, a happy accident. So just work with your happy accident. Maybe you're not brave enough to even try a full peacock bird. You could just practice with the feathers, or do, you know, take these little abstract peacock inspired spots and do just some abstract backgrounds with peacock feather spots on them. That would be interesting. And don't forget, watercolor can be used in conjunction with mixed media, but it will reactivate with water, at least a little bit. But if you have a piece that you really love, you can always photocopy it and use the photocopy in your mixed media as a collage element, as a stick. You could print it on sticker paper. You could print it on cardstock. Something like that. That would be fun. Okay. I'm going to just do each one of our spots. Depending on how big you've chosen to do your peacock, this could be kind of meditative. You could just put some nice music on. Because peacock birds are kind of iridescent, their feathers are iridescent, if you have a metallic watercolor, this would be a good project to add it to. I have some somewhere. Maybe I gotta find it. I've got some twinkling H2Os. All right. I like the way that's looking. I don't know about you guys. I like it. I like it. All right. What next? We should do something about his legs. So we're going to stay with the tiger's eye color. And I'm going to come in here and I'm going to just suggest his legs. I'm not looking, of course, because I'm an expressive abstract painter. I'm not looking for realism. So good morning, all of the new people who are joining us. It is a very, I love the that's a good term for it, a reactive look. And I love the way it comes out. I love kind of not exactly knowing what I'm going to get and working with it to create my shape that I want. All right, I love this. I'm really wanting to do something crazy. Those of you who watched me before, now you're just shaking your heads, I know. So I have this color Moon Glow, and you all know it's my favorite Daniel Smith color. It's a purpley gray color. It's a cool color, so it's a shadow color. Thank you. So I'm going to, I'm going to add some of it to our bird. Now this is not a realistic color because this color is not in peacocks. It's a, you know, it's a purple. But it's a great color for these kind of paintings. Now, these marks here on his neck, I kind of like the way those came out, so I'm not going to add too much plain water because I want to leave some of those marks. You know, after a while of painting, you're going to start to get these instincts about things, and you're going to start to get impulses to, you know, add certain colors or make a certain mark. Even if it doesn't turn out and you end up not liking what happened, just try it anyways, because the way you best way to learn is through just doing it, in my opinion. I'm just surrounding his head a little bit with some of this Moon Glow color. Alright, I want to darken up this area here where these kind of clump of tail feathers are up against his body. I'm going to add some of our phthalo yellow green that we used before. And then I'm going to add some water. And I may get some of the moon glow mixing in with it, like right there. You see it blooming in? I love that. I'm okay with that. I might add more of that and encourage that because I think that's interesting. Where's my moon glow? And yes, the purple is going to mix with the green a bit and we're going to get something that looks brown. I'm totally all right with that. So I am on here once a week with watercolor, Wednesday. Unless I am on vacation and out of town, I am here. And then every other week, I am here on Monday for acrylic painting, for Monday with deco art. And I think I'm due to have one of those next week. I take suggestions on what you want to paint on Facebook in my Facebook group. No, acrylic and watercolor. I can't paint with oils. I have too many allergies and asthma. They make me wheeze. I'm going to bring in some of our cobalt teal. I am just suggesting these feathers. I'm not painting them. I'm giving the impression of the feathers. I have some oil paint sticks. I do use them occasionally, but they don't have the same sort of odors that bother me that oil paints do. And I love my oil paint sticks. My new favorite brand that I just discovered is... Shiva oil paint sticks. They're not super expensive. And I got caught up in painting. I got them at Dick Blick. They're blue and green. Two of my favorite colors. So we're just suggesting this clump of feathers right here. We're not, you know, painting it. We have a few of our, you know, suggestive sort of half-circle-y, fish-scale-y shapes. But I'm not doing a lot to, you know, really paint in each feather. If you're the kind of painter that wants to do that, by all means. But, I'm not interested in doing that. So I'm going to work a little bit on this part. And we are going to come back in with more of the Tiger's Eye Genuine. And I'm going to pull out some lines along the pencil lines I drew earlier. I like to have fun with my paint. I like to not be frustrated by being worried about painting in tons of details. It's just not me. So I'm going to paint a few of these lines again, like before with the spots. I'm, you know, really barely touching my brush to the paper. I'm going to come in with some plain water after I've done a few, and I'm going to touch it to, I'll answer that in a minute. I'm going to touch it to a few spots on the lines that I just painted, but not all of it. I want maybe some of it to blend a little bit, but I don't want all of it to blend a bit. So they're not really different. The Shiva oil paint sticks take about a day to completely dry, but once they do, they're hard. Oil pastels, like portfolio oil pastels, are always going to be water soluble. But they're both basically oil paint. They're a little bit different formula than oil paint, but they're both basically oil paint. I use them together a lot. I have a fancy brand of oil pastels that I actually don't like. And they may actually show up soon on... one of the resale sites. It's not that they are horrible or anything. They're just not as easy to use in mixed media, I don't think. So I'm going to add some extra pigment in a few places. And then I'm going to come in with the back end of my... No, I'm not either. This is... I don't know what... I think this is a knitting thing. It's a double-pointed... And I'm going to come in here and I'm going to, in the water, in the wet water, and we're going to get some lines in here that will suggest, you know, feather hairs, feather. With the oil sticks, yeah, they're going to be showing up in quite a few YouTube videos this year, actually. I'm doing a lot more true mixed media pieces than I have in the past, where I just get stuck doing acrylic or watercolor. You're welcome. Just remind me I said that, Lisa. So then you can have the suggestion of the little feather hairs. I don't know what they're called, the little things. I think you guys have told me before, because I think one of you has birds. But I don't remember. Okay, then I'm going to come in, of course, with some plain water. Maybe add a little extra pigment. Now, of course, if you did this before you put your spots in, that might be better, because then you don't have to worry about where your spots are at and going around your spots. Of course, I didn't think of that, because, you know, let's see if we can have the paper not bounce around. So the scratch marks are going to, the watercolor paint is going to settle in the scratch marks. So you're going to get these faint suggestive lines in your painting without actually putting them in there with a paintbrush. Blending out some of the edges a little bit, so it's more, still more of a suggestive wash. I like that. All right, let's keep going. Yeah. I'll put the knitting needle down before I poke myself in the eye. You know, I was gonna make another cup of coffee before I started this broadcast, and I didn't. I'm thinking that was a mistake. I feel like I need more coffee. Oop, that's the wrong color. So I like how, you know, if I don't reload the brush, then I get a lighter and lighter line, and it just gives you a natural variation in color. No, I've had 2 cups, which is normally my limit. but, you know, it's just, I just feel like I need more coffee. It's one of those days. I don't know what to say. So just do a few of these, you know, feathers, and then go back and put your scratch marks in. Add some more pigment if you need to. Oh, you're welcome. It'll be up on YouTube as soon as I can get it up there. Keep doing the same steps over and over. Turn on your favorite music, turn it up loud, and just paint. Try not to poke yourself in the eye with whatever it is that you're scratching with. I've almost poked myself a couple times. It is starting to gather, come together. Every painting you ever do will have what I call the ugly duckling stage. Everyone. So if you're working on a painting and you're thinking, holy cow, I don't know about this. It's really ugly. Just keep working it. Sometimes it gets ugly and stays ugly. That happens to the best of us. But it's not always the case. So just keep working it and see what happens. I do have a few pieces that have gotten ugly and stayed that way. Because, you know, nobody's perfect. I'm far from perfect. Okay. Got a couple more. And while I'm doing these feathers, it's giving everything else a chance to dry. So then if I want to, I can come back and add, you know, more to my bird. More. He needs something on his eye. Thank you. All right. So I keep sharp pointy sticks around for doing things like that. Now you also can lift by getting a rag in here where paint is wet. Now see, that's already dry, but where paint is wet, you can, you know, stick the rag in there and it'll absorb some of the paint. With these kind of paints, because they're artist grade, they stain pretty well. So you have less, you're less likely to be able to do that. Now I'm going to go in with something dark. I think we're going to, we're going to stick with, I'm going to follow my instincts. It's something I'm always telling you guys to do, isn't it? So I'm going to go in. Thank you. This is Moon Glow, which is a Daniel Smith color. It's unique to their brand. It is a purpley gray color. And I'm going to use it as, in conjunction with Payne's Gray, as my shadow color. When you're painting, any piece, whether you're working on a mixed media art journal piece or you're working on watercolor, acrylic painting, a good balance of lights and darks, a little pop of something bright will make your piece really interesting. If they're all the same tone, all the colors are the same tone and value, then the piece may look good, but you know there's something wrong with it. It's off a bit, and you know may not be able to tell exactly what it is. Add a little pop of something dark or something light, and that might help solve your problem. If you're worried about it, make a photocopy of the original and try it on the photocopy first before you put pen or paper to the original. Let's see what that dark did. So I haven't switched colors. This is just the Moon Glow color. And it's letting his body stand out a bit from his tail feathers by putting a shadow there. Making him look a little bit more two-dimensional rather than one-dimensional. Lift a little bit of this here on this clump of tail feathers. That's good. They are gorgeous birds, and you know, when you go to someplace like Hawaii, they're all over the place. Well, peacocks and chickens. if you haven't been to Hawaii, Hawaii has a problem with chickens everywhere. Wild chickens. They're literally everywhere. Ask my friend Claudia Rossi. She lives in Hawaii. Okay. So that just made a big difference, didn't it? So the other thing I want to do is I'm going to come in here with a color I don't use a lot, which is black. Exactly. So the body now is starting to stand out from the feathers behind him. And while that dries a little bit, I'm going to come in here to the eye and I'm going to just darken where his eye is with just black. which is a lot darker than the Payne's Gray, and it's going to really make his eyeball prevalent. Then I'm going to rinse my brush off. I'm going to take some Payne's Gray, which is not as dark as the black. And I'm going to come in with just the tip of my paintbrush. And I'm going to put in some lines where there's kind of these feathery lines around his face and around his eye. And I'm not going to blend these. These I'm going to be leaving. There. Maybe I'll blend the one that's in the wrong spot. Blend it out. There we go. That's better. Okay, so, and this is dry here now, so I'm going to come in with some more ultramarine blue. Now, if you're using your watercolors in conjunction with a mixed media piece and like acrylic paints, there's no reason why you couldn't use the watercolors for a base and then come in here with some acrylic paints and add in your second layer with acrylic paints. You definitely could do that. Especially if you have something that's kind of on the sheer translucent side, like golden fluid acrylics or something. And you notice I just got in there and I did this with my finger. You know, another blending tool, your fingers, they work great. The other thing to do is make sure that you have all your light sources coming from the same, the right way, and all your dark on the, you know, if you need to put a post-it note next to your piece that says sun and an arrow. I lose track sometimes when I'm painting of where I intended for the sun to be. Okay, not sometimes. It happens kind of a lot because I get lost in the painting process. So, you know, it happens. All right, I'm going to rinse off my brush. I like this cobalt teal, so let's add some of this to our bird on the light side. Ooh, 11:03. See, I could just go keep going on this bird. Does anybody have any questions before we end the broadcast? As I finish up our bird. I'm leaving some brush marks down here, and I am liking the way they're suggesting feathers on his body, so we're going to leave them. I am going to take some of my blue colors that I've used, and or maybe not, maybe what's on my palette that I just have here, I'm going to add some water to it, and I'm going to flick it onto my piece. I like the way that looks, and I'm going to, let's do some stamping, shall we? Let's see. I have lots of background rubber stamps, and I use them frequently in this book. Thank you. In this journal. Ooh, I like this one. I don't know why I do, because it has nothing to do with peacocks, but it's a honeycomb stamp. This is by Indigo Blue, and it's called Honeycomb Background. And let's get some ink. What color do we want? I think I want to do blue. I have this Pretty Blue by Studio G. I don't know what color it is. I don't think it says. If it says, it's in little print that I can't read without my reading glasses. But you can use any ink. I mean, you know, if you're worried about it running or smearing, use waterproof ink like archival ink, but... There we go. I like that. That's a nice page. Any questions? Thank you, Cheryl. So whether you paint this a peacock or just the feathers, no matter how it turns out, you know, just consider, you know, work in a book like this, and these are just your practice pieces. And then if you just paint something that you really like, then you can do it on a big piece of paper. But use your watercolor journal to do studies, to practice techniques, to practice composition, and, you know, just to work through different images, you know, and some of them will turn out and some of them won't. It's okay. Just enjoy the process. And don't forget that the copy of the photo I used for reference is up on my website, GinaBArons.com. And you can download it from there. And if you do paint a peacock, I would love to see it. You can share it over in the Facebook group, A Life of Art and Self-Expression. You can find links to the Facebook group in this broadcast earlier on, or the name of the Facebook group. You can also go to my website, and there's links to it over there somewhere. All right, everybody have a great day. Don't forget to go out and do something nice for yourself, because you deserve it. Play with your paints. All right, I'll see you all later. Bye.